What happens if we're all wrong? What happens if we've all been deceived into believing something that is not written in our Bibles? What happens if we've been resisting the Holy Spirit our whole life? What happens if we've been grieving the Spirit, making the Spirit jealous, quenching the Spirit, and even insulting the Spirit of grace all this time? What happens if there's a difference between being saved initially and being saved in the end, and all we've been preaching is the first one? Deceiving people. Who would believe the scriptures? Who would believe the word of God that Jesus spoke through his disciples? Who would allow the word of God to judge the thoughts and the intents of their hearts? Who would take every thought captive to make it obedient to Christ? In this video, Lord willing, I'm going to show you the difference between being saved initially and being saved in the end, and what we're being saved from according to Scripture. All I ask is that you believe the Scriptures. Believe them in your heart. And once you believe them, never speak against them again.
Never speak against them again.
Let us repent and return to the Lord our God.
You think about it. We can confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead and be saved. And yet, according to Jesus Christ, we still have to endure until the end in order to be saved. He who endures until the end will be saved. Yes or no? Either we believe Jesus Christ or we don't. I'm going to show you that in the beginning, we were made alive from the dead. Ephesians chapter 2, 5 and 6. In the end, we're being saved from the wrath of God through Jesus Christ. Get your Bible out and let's get started. In the end, Jesus saves those who come to God through him. That's totally different from being saved by grace through faith. Jesus saves those who serve God from the wrath of God in the end. And that's two different things. If we would just believe the scriptures in our hearts, then we would see that God saves us by grace through faith, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. And in the end, Jesus saves those who come to God through him. And that's two different things. If we looked at the scriptures by what we're being saved from, then that would help us to understand them. Think about this right here. Jesus said, "No one can come to the Father except through him." We all know that one. We think it's talking about at the beginning, but it's actually talking about at the end. Take a look at John 6, 44. Jesus also said, "No one can come to him unless the Father who sent him draws that person." That's the one talking about at the beginning. God saves us and sends us to Jesus. And then Jesus saves those who come to God through him. Same thing down in verse 65. Jesus said, "No one can come to him unless he has been granted by my Father." Okay, we have to be granted by God to come to Jesus, or enabled to come to Jesus. And we have to go through Jesus in order to get to God. That's two different things. God saves us, sends us to Jesus, and then Jesus saves those who come to God through him. To be granted is to be allowed or permitted. Okay, but either way, it's not an automatic thing like we preach it. Okay, it's conditional. And when we don't mention the conditions, then we leave room for people to just fill in the blanks with what they think. That's never a good idea. The way that seems right ends in death. Always stick with the scriptures. You know, if you think about it, you know, one church preaches this set of, say, 20 scriptures on being saved, and the church across the street preaches a different set of 20 scriptures on being saved, and some of them may be the same, okay, but that's the reason why our interpretation on how to make it into the kingdom of heaven doesn't match from church to church, and that's even if we're using the same Bible. For example, some churches preach Acts 2:38, "Repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins." Or some Bibles change that to "the forgiveness of sins." and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost in the King James. Praise God, hallelujah. Okay, but if we skip a couple of things, we can get down to be saved from this perverse generation, down in verse 40. If we skip a couple of things, we don't mention the condition at the end of verse 39, as many as the Lord God will call. Okay, but God has to enable us or grant us to come to Jesus. There it is again. God saves us, and then he teaches us how to love one another, and then sends us to Jesus. Those who heard and learned from God come to Jesus. John 6:45. And we don't mention that Peter taught a whole lot more than just repentance and baptism. With many other words, he exhorted the people, or he strongly urged the people. Because living by faith in Jesus Christ requires a whole lot more than just repentance and baptism. You know, that's not the only two things that Jesus told us to do. Repentance and baptism are acts of faith in Jesus Christ, and they are required in order to become the righteousness of God in Christ, because we have to live by faith in Jesus Christ and we have to believe. But I'm going to show you they're not required at the beginning of the Christian life. They are required in order to be saved at the end of the Christian life. It's not like I have a problem with Acts 2:38. It's just that I don't have a problem with Acts 2:21 either, or Romans chapter 10, verse 13. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And I don't have a problem with Romans 10, 9. If we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we will be saved. And I don't have a problem with Acts 16, where Paul and Silas was asked point blank, what must I do to be saved? Their answer, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. How about those churches that just preach the message of the cross without even mentioning the word saved? Can they be saved? Jesus Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried, rose again on the third day according to the scriptures. The word saved is not even in there. Okay, but get this right here. God saves those who believe the message, Christ crucified. 1 Corinthians 1:21 through 23. Yes or no? The message of the cross is the power of God for being saved. Imagine that. So how do all these scriptures on being saved fit together? Okay, or do they fit together? Do we have to repent and get baptized in order to be saved initially? Look at Ephesians chapter 2. But God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love, which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up together, and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. Look at verse 8. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Imagine that. Even while we were dead in trespasses, God made us alive. In other words, by grace, he saved us, even without us doing anything. There's nothing in that passage of scripture that says that we had to do anything before God saved us initially. Before that time, we were dead in trespasses and sins when we followed the ways of the world, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. By nature, we were children of wrath, just like everybody else. That's the condition we were in when God saved us initially. No hope and without God in the world, and he simply made us alive from the dead. By grace, we have been saved. Yes or no? And that's past tense. Have been saved. That's what it means to be saved initially. Made alive, reconciled to God through the death of his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. God saved us by grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. That's what it means to be justified freely by grace. The free gift, being saved by grace through faith, resulted in justification. Yes or no? So what does that mean exactly? Okay, well, Jesus Christ not only died for our sins, but the sins of the whole world, everybody's sins. Therefore, the free gift, being saved by grace through faith, resulted in the justification of all men. Romans 5:18. Yes or no? We were all sanctified by the body of Jesus, Hebrews 13, verse 12. We were all sanctified by the blood, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 10. We were all justified by the blood, Romans chapter 5, verse 9. And we were all justified freely by grace, Romans chapter 3, verse 24, Titus chapter 3, verse 7. So the question is not if God saved us initially. The question is, do we believe Jesus? Because we're going to have to believe in order to be saved from the wrath of God in the end. Anyone who calls on the name of the Lord can be saved. Point blank, period. So the question is not if we got saved. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10. God saved both those who will believe as well as those who will not believe. Yes or no? Like I said, the free gift resulted in the justification of all men. Jesus Christ died for everybody's sins, but that doesn't mean that everybody is going to make it to heaven. Let this sink in right here, because there are some who preach that if we return to the ways of this world, then we were never saved to begin with. But that's false. God saved both those who will believe as well as those who will not believe, and the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. He gave each of us a measure of faith. Yes or no? So if we shipwreck our faith and return to the ways of this world after being saved, then we will simply be like the prodigal son. While he was away, he was D-E-A-D, dead. When he returned, he was alive again. If we return to the ways of this world, we simply need to do like the prodigal son. We need to repent and return to God. Read 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 20 down through verse 22. Read that passage of scripture out loud like 5 to 10 times until it breaks a stronghold in your thinking. Okay, and that would be like the end of that discussion. If you would just simply read that passage of scripture like 10 times out loud, so it would break the stronghold in your thinking. Think about this right here. What did God save us from to begin with? We were dead in trespasses and sins when we followed the ways of this world, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. By nature, we were children of wrath, just like everybody else. We were controlled by a spirit that made us disobey and didn't even know it. In other words, spiritually speaking, we were dead, just like the prodigal son was dead while he was away, wasting his possessions on prodigal living. When he returned to God, he was alive again. In the same way, after being saved, if we return to the ways of this world to become a friend of the world, we will become God's enemy. Christians who set their minds on the things of this world are enemies of the cross of Christ. Yes or no? You see, before we were saved, we were enemies in our minds by wicked works. But Christ died for us to present us holy, blameless, and above reproach in God's sight if we continue in our faith. Okay, and so if we return to that, then we will simply be enemies of the cross of Christ until we repent and return to God. There's a huge group of Christians like that. And there's even churches, there's even whole denominations set up to serve them and that feed off of them. But get this now. What did the Lord tell us to do? Leave them alone. Matthew 15, verse 14. If the blind leads the blind, both will fall. We still got to love them. We've got to overcome evil with good. We even love our enemies. If your enemy's hungry, do what? Feed him. If he's thirsty, do what? Give him something to drink. In doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head. So don't be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. When we were saved initially, we were saved by grace through faith as the gift of God. But not all of us, not everyone who was saved initially, will be saved in the end from the wrath of God.
Why is that? Because not everyone who was saved initially believes Jesus. It's just like it was 2,000 years ago. Disciples of Jesus Christ stopped following Jesus. Why? This is saved people I'm talking about here. They stopped following Jesus. John 6, 66. Why? Look up in verse 60. Because Jesus said something that they didn't like. The same thing is happening today. People get saved and believe up to a point, and then that's it. Okay, they're done. Out of all the people who were saved initially, only those who believe Jesus are going to live by faith. The rest, the people who don't believe, they're just not going to follow Jesus. It doesn't matter to them. For example, they're not going to endure to the end because they don't believe what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 24, verse 13. So they just ignore that. They're not going to abide in Jesus because they don't believe what Jesus said in John 15, verse 6. They're not going to obey Jesus because they just ignore John 15, verse 14, and Luke 6, 46, and verses like Hebrews chapter 5, verse 9. Jesus is the source of eternal salvation for those who obey him. They don't care anything about what Peter said in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 10 and verse 11. So they're not going to make their calling and election sure. They're just going to ignore the things that we can do in order not to stumble again and receive an abundant entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. They're just going to ignore that verse. They're not going to deny themselves, pick up their cross daily, and follow Jesus because they don't believe Luke chapter 9, 23, 24. They don't believe that's a verse talking about being saved in the end. They don't believe what Jesus said about those who find their life will lose it, but only those who lose their life for him will find it. They don't believe that. But the word of the Lord endures forever. Heaven and earth will pass away, but Jesus's words aren't going anywhere. They don't care that the Apostle Paul served God in his spirit, Romans chapter 1, verse 9, or that he served God with a pure conscience, and that we're supposed to be waging good warfare, holding on to faith and a good conscience. They're not going to serve God in their mind, according to Romans chapter 7, verse 25. But Jesus saves those who serve God
from the wrath of God to come. Okay, he delivers us from the wrath to come, those who serve God. But some people get saved and they don't want to serve God. Everyone who practices evil hates the light. Let that sink in for a second. Okay, you're not just going to change that with a conversation. They need grace.
They need grace. We need grace to live this Christian life. So we boldly go to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. But we can't use grace as a license to continue in sin. It's not going to work out. If we sin willfully after receiving the knowledge of the truth, then there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful expectation of judgment and fiery indignation that will devour the adversaries. Imagine that. Hebrews chapter 10, 26, 27. But now here's the deal. If we repent and return to the Lord and start back in our faith, now faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So we're going to read the Word of God out loud. We're going to believe it in our heart. Hear it in our ears, believe it in our heart. But if we repent and return to the Lord according to His ways, then we're going to have peace with God and access to grace. And then grace is going to teach us.
Grace teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust and to live righteously, soberly, and godly in this present age, right here, right now. And acts of faith are according to grace, because God gave us the faith, God gave us the grace, and grace gives us the ability to do the work. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 10. Learn that for yourself. But now the problem is that people who were saved initially by grace through faith, but practice evil, hate the light. They don't want to offer God their body as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God, which is our reasonable service back to God for what He's done for us. They don't want to stop conforming to this world and be transformed by renewing their minds. They don't want to do that. They don't want to serve God. They don't want to offer their members. Members are body parts. They don't want to offer their members to God as instruments of righteousness rather than offering their members as instruments of unrighteousness. Romans chapter 6, verse 13. And so unless they repent and return, they will never be able to obey the doctrine to the point of becoming a slave of righteousness or a slave of righteous acts to the point of being set free from sin. Romans 6, 17 and 18. Yes or no? See, their issue is not with being saved initially. They accept that Jesus Christ died for our sins. They accept that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Okay, they accept that they are saved and seated with Christ. They accept that the body of Jesus sanctified us. They accept that the blood of Jesus sanctified us. They accept that the blood of Jesus Christ justified us, and we're justified freely by grace. But they don't accept that the gospel now requires those who were justified to live by faith in Jesus Christ and believe. So they don't want to serve God acceptably with reverence and fear. But Jesus saves those who serve God from the wrath of God in the end. So they're saved now, but they won't be saved in the end. They just simply go to churches that never mention these scriptures. But what will they do on the day of judgment? Let us repent and return
to the Lord our God. Get this right here. If we continue in grace, as we're instructed to do, and we continue in the faith that we were given initially, saved by grace through faith, and we fight the good fight of faith, laying hold to eternal life, waging good warfare, holding on to faith and a good conscience, then that same faith that we received to begin with will result in the salvation of our souls in the end. But we have to fight the good fight, finish the race, and keep the faith. That's what it's all about. The question is not if we receive the gift, but what are we doing with that gift? Are we continuing in our faith? Are we holding on to faith and a good conscience in keeping with our instructions? The end of our faith, the end of that gift that we were given, is the salvation of our souls. But the wages that sin pays is death. So in order for the gift of God that we were given to result in eternal life in the end, our fruit would need to be to holiness. If our fruit is to holiness, then the end result is everlasting life. But the wages that sin pays is death. So if we remain a slave to sin and we're not controlled by righteousness, then our fruit will be unto death. Understand that. A slave to sin does not abide in the house forever. He's in the house right now, but he doesn't have a permanent place in the house.
So we got to be set free from being a slave to sin. That doesn't necessarily mean that we won't sin again. It means that we won't be a slave to sin. Understand that. So how are we going to do that? Okay, through knowing the truth. Okay, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. We're going to know the truth, and then we're going to put it into practice. Or the King James says, doeth. 1 John chapter 2, verse 29. We're going to practice righteousness, or doeth righteousness. Okay, all those who are born of God practice righteousness. And those who are not born of God do not practice righteousness. Understand that. So we're going to put it into practice. Okay, and just by obeying the doctrine, okay, Romans 6, 17. Just by obeying the teachings, we can be set free from being a slave to sin, set free from sin, or set free from sin's control. And that would give us an opportunity to become slaves of righteousness, offering our body parts to God as instruments of righteousness. Understand that. That means that being transformed is not optional. Stop conforming to this world and be transformed by renewing your minds. That's not optional. We have to be transformed. There has to be a change. Look at Acts chapter 3, verse 19. Peter taught conversion as if it had to happen, yes or no. Jesus taught the same thing in Matthew chapter 18. It's not optional. There has to be a change. Okay, and that's how we serve God. Stop conforming to this world. Be transformed by renewing our minds. It has to happen. So we're going to have to renew our minds with the truth. We're going to have to put off the old man with our former conduct, be renewed in the spirit of our minds, put on the new man created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Do we have to be converted in order to be saved initially? No, we didn't have to do anything. The key here is have to. We didn't have to do anything in order to be saved initially. Okay, look at Titus chapter 3, starting in verse 3.
For we ourselves were also once foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving various lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. Verse 4, but when the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. As past tense, he saved us through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us abundantly through Jesus Christ. Christ our Savior, that having been justified by his grace, there it is again, having been justified by his grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Now notice that, having been justified, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Being saved initially does not mean that we're automatically heirs or have an inheritance. Having been justified by his grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This is a faithful saying, and these things I want you to affirm constantly, that those who have believed in God should be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable to men. Notice that you don't see things like getting baptized in order to be saved, according to that verse. You don't see repenting in order to be saved. You don't see an altar call or a public confession of faith, in other words, or saying a sinner's prayer in order to be saved, because none of those things are required initially for being saved initially, but all of those things are required for being saved in the end, because faith in Jesus Christ includes those things. Just like faith in God made Noah Noah build the ark. Faith in Jesus Christ will make us follow our instructions. We live by faith in Jesus Christ so that we will become the righteousness of God in Him. Live by faith in Jesus Christ and believe, Romans 3:22, so that we will become the righteousness of God in Him, so that we will be saved from the wrath of God in the end. Now, some people are led into doing acts of righteousness before God saved them, such as baptism or repenting. Okay, so I'm not speaking against that, because God does accept those who fear Him and do acts of righteousness or works righteousness, such as helping people in need or baptism or repentance or anything in line with faith in Jesus Christ. Acts chapter 10, verse 35. Know that for yourself. We're not saved initially by works of righteousness or acts of righteousness, which we have done. But now that we are saved, we are expected to do acts of righteousness in keeping with faith in Jesus Christ. We were created in Christ Jesus to do good works. We should be affirming constantly that Christians should maintain good works. Imagine that. So we should be offering our members, our body parts to God as instruments of righteousness, even to the point of becoming a slave of righteousness. Yes or no? But get this right here. What happens if we don't become a slave of righteousness? What happens if we don't have any righteous acts? Revelation chapter 3, verse 5 happens. Look at the parable of the wedding feast in Matthew chapter 22. The parable of the wedding feast. Here's a guy who made it all the way into the kingdom of heaven at the wedding feast. But there was a problem. He didn't have on wedding clothes. So what happened? He was cast out into outer darkness. Yes or no? Imagine that. He made it all the way into the wedding feast in the kingdom of heaven before he was cast out. For whatever reason, he obviously didn't believe what Jesus said in Revelation chapter 3, verse 5. For whatever reason, he who overcomes shall be clothed in white, and I will not blot his name out of the book of life. Yes or no? I would write that down if I was you, so that you won't be deceived when some preacher tells you the exact opposite. Let us repent and return to the Lord our God. You see, our inheritance is not based on being saved initially. Our inheritance is based on trusting Jesus. God saved those who will believe as well as those who will not believe. Our inheritance is based on trusting Jesus, hearing and believing the gospel of our salvation in order to be sealed in the Holy Spirit and guaranteed an inheritance. Before that time, we could be resisting the Holy Spirit continuously, quenching the Spirit, making the Spirit jealous, and even grieving the Holy Spirit. We can grieve the Holy Spirit even after we're sealed for the day of redemption. Yes or no? You see, everybody who wanted the gift of God, saved by grace through faith, received the gift of God through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. We were all justified freely by grace. The free gift resulted in the justification of all men. But the gospel adds some new requirements. Yeah, now those who have been justified have to live by faith. The gospel requires those who have been justified to now live by faith in Jesus Christ and believe. So believing Christians go from having been justified by the blood and justified freely by grace to being justified by faith. God is the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus Christ. But those who refuse to live by faith in Jesus Christ don't have peace with God, and they don't have access to more grace through faith. Romans chapter 5, verse 1 and verse 2. Learn that for yourself. Also, according to the gospel, we have to be sanctified by the Spirit and believe the truth. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, 13 and 14. That's a part of the gospel, and the gospel calls us to that for the obtaining of the glory of the Lord. Imagine that for a second. If you haven't heard that, then you have not heard the complete gospel. And there is no way that those who don't believe that can be sealed in the Holy Spirit and guaranteed an inheritance. They are resisting the Holy Spirit. But the gospel calls us to the sanctifying work of the Spirit and believing the truth. I would write that down. I would not wait till this weekend expecting to hear it, because sanctification by the Spirit is the only acceptable offering for Gentiles, non-Jews. Romans 15, verse 16. Write that down.
It's a part of the gospel. If we do not hear and believe the gospel, we will not be sealed in the Holy Spirit and guaranteed an inheritance. Yes, we were sanctified by the blood. Yes, we were sanctified by the body of Jesus. But the gospel requires us to be sanctified by the Spirit. Point blank. Period. Now we're being sanctified in conduct because we're putting to death the deeds of the body by the Spirit. If we live according to the flesh, we're going to die. But if by the Spirit we put to death the deeds of the body, we will live. A part of God's will for our life is that we be holy, that we be sanctified, made holy. Okay, and you're going to hear people say, well, Jesus makes us holy in God's sight. Well, yes, he does, if we continue in our faith. He makes us holy, blameless, and above reproach in God's sight. But understand this right here. The gospel requires us to be holy in conduct because the blood of Jesus Christ has also redeemed us from our aimless conduct. So we are pursuing peace and holiness so that we don't fall short of the grace of God. And we're living by faith in Jesus Christ and believing even to the point of becoming the righteousness of God so that we don't receive grace in vain. Learn those scriptures for yourself. That's why we have to sow to the Spirit in order to reap everlasting life. Galatians chapter 6, verse 8. Let that sink in. If we sow to the flesh, we will reap corruption. But if we sow to the Spirit, we will reap everlasting life. If we're sowing to the Spirit, then we're putting to death the deeds of the body by the Spirit, by keeping our minds set on the things above. And get this right here. Jesus has perfected forever those who are in the process of being sanctified. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 14. Okay, he is one with those who are in the process of being sanctified, and he's not ashamed to call them brother. Imagine that. Let that sink in for a second. But those who live according to the flesh will die. So how about those who believe the gospel and are baptized? Will they be saved? Yeah. But how about those who don't believe? Belief is a condition. Yes or no? What if a person called on the name of the Lord to be saved, and then later they rejected the gospel? Are they still saved? How would you answer that question according to Scripture? Who preaches Romans 15, verse 16? Who preaches 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, 13 through 14? There are millions of Christians today who have rejected the gospel. So what's going to happen? What does the Scripture say? Is there such a thing as believing in vain? Is there such a thing as being saved if we hold fast to the word that was preached, unless we believed in vain? Because if there is, there are thousands of sermons today that are false, that are deceiving millions of Christians who don't know the Scriptures for themselves. Let us repent and return to the Lord our God. Belief is a condition. If we keep rejecting Scriptures like 1 Corinthians 15, 1 and 2, at some point, the philosophy-based teachings that we've come to accept and believe are going to cheat us. We were saved by grace through faith at the beginning of the Christian life, but we have to continue in our faith all the way to the salvation of the soul. With the heart, we believe unto righteousness, all the way to being righteous. With the mouth, confession is made unto salvation, all the way to salvation. The end of our faith is the salvation of our souls. So even though we were saved initially by grace through faith, we still have to endure until the end in order to be saved from the wrath of God in the end. And that's two different things. That's why if a brother wanders from the truth, someone has to turn him back in order to save his soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. If he doesn't turn back, he's going to lose his soul. Yes, or no. Contrary to popular belief, a Christian who is steadfast in the faith, can be led away by the error of the wicked. Yes or no? We have to hear this word and we have to believe this word. Look at Jude chapter 1, verse 5. Although the Lord saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward, what did he do? He destroyed those who did not believe. Yes or no? Same thing is going to happen again. And some people are going to say, well, that's something that happened in Egypt. And that's why we have to ignore 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 11. The things that happened to Israel in the past happened as examples, and they were written for our admonition. In other words, it's a warning for us upon whom the end of the age has come. Yes or no? So the same thing is going to happen again. The bottom line is that all unbelievers were destroyed out of Egypt, and the same thing is going to happen again. All who do not believe but had pleasure in unrighteousness will be condemned. It's just that simple. Belief is a condition. Every sermon that you have ever heard that violated the scriptures that we have covered today was wrong. And that's probably millions of sermons by now, by thousands of preachers, because this thing didn't just start last week. This has been going on for over 100 years, as best that I can tell. And we're all guilty. Okay, I'm not saying that I'm not guilty. I'm just saying that we have an opportunity. We're still living. We can repent and return to the Lord our God. We can accept the word of God just like it is written. We've got that opportunity. We can confess our sins, repent, return to God, and trust Jesus, hear and believe the gospel of our salvation, and be sealed in the Holy Spirit and guaranteed an inheritance starting today. May the Lord bless you and keep you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.